It's all about winning, right? Vince Lombardi, who said that winning isn't everything, it's the only thing. And unfortunately, I think our culture has bought into that, but we're not the first culture to do that. Winning all the time is what you need to do. I listen to a lot of sports radio when I'm driving around. That's probably pretty pathetic of me, but I do. Sometimes I do it because of Ashley Wallace is on, and so Bob's granddaughter, and I always keep track of her, which I don't know why she missed being at Cedar Point when they were there doing a live remote, but that's another issue. But then, you know, one of the big debates that ESPN seems to always have on the radio things is, does somebody have to have won one or more championships to be considered an all-time great? And that comes up all the time, every sport, every season, and yeah, it does get old after a while. But in our culture and in several others, they think that way. It's really important to win, and we all want the Indians to win, whether it's the Cleveland Indians or the Rittman Indians. We all want that. Well, most of us want that, and it is very important. For Elisha, remember, that's where we're at. We're going through the life of Elisha. Elisha, it was pretty important. He needed some victories. He needed to stock up and stack up and stockpile some wins in order to prove that he was indeed God's anointed prophet to take the place of Elijah. And I think we looked at a couple things last week. We looked at one miracle that occurred according to his ministry. We're going to look at another one today. I think God did these, especially the one today, for a couple reasons. One was to show again and again and again that Elisha was approved by God, someone that he was going to use. And I think also God was bringing certain people at this particular time. Here's an interesting verse. Okay. That was an interesting verse. Maybe my battery. There it is. It is better to meet a bear robbed of her cubs than a fool in his folly. Wow. A bear. Now, this is probably sensitive material when we have people at GBB High Adventure right now. And they're on that island off the coast and... But I don't think there's bears. Wild horses, but I don't think there's bears there. But a bear that has lost her cubs is a ferocious, furious bear. Not in a happy mood. You do not want to run into that bear while walking down a dark alley late at night. You don't want to do that. You don't want anything to do with that situation. And the writer of Proverbs says, as bad as that is, it's worse to be around a fool and who's in his folly. Now think about that. That's a pretty graphic illustration. Bears, and you know, they're pretty mean and they're very, very bad, but it's worse to be around a fool. Thank you, Alex. I'm gonna assume this is gone, so thank you. Who is a fool? So in Psalms 14:1, it says that a fool has said in his heart that there is no God. An atheist, someone who does not believe in God, is what the Bible calls and what God calls a fool. Now, isn't that interesting? Because there's lots of atheists in our land, and a lot of them have worked their ways up to important positions, whether it's politically or academically, scientifically, and some of them are the ones who say that you are foolish for believing in a God. You're just weak-kneed people that need a crutch to stand on, so you create this little God personality. But yet God turns around and says, you know what, they're the fools. They're the fools. Now, I added a couple more categories. I've got another one that says someone who places other gods above God. Now, that's not an atheist, but I think they're fools too. and they're putting something or someone above the one true creator, sovereign God. And I think that's a pretty foolish thing to do. Another category I have is someone who opposes what God is doing. They may know that there's a God, and they hate the fact that there's a God, and they're going to oppose that God, and they're going to do all kinds of things to offset that particular work of God. And that's where we're at, I think, tonight, as we look at this particular person. What is his foolishness like? What is his folly? It's the ways and the work that he does to oppose God. It is idiotic to oppose the one who made you and who rules the universe. That's ridiculous to do that. How stupid, how dumb, how foolish that is for someone to do. But yet, you can name people who do that all the time. And they consider themselves pretty good, pretty sharp, pretty wonderful people. It's far better to come across a mama bear, or since it's Father's Day, a papa bear, who's angry and grieving over their lost cubs. It is far better to come across those bears than it would be to come across someone who opposes and does not know God. Okay, why are we talking about bears? It's Father's Day and you're an Elisha. And okay, that's why we got to go to 2 Kings chapter 2 and take a look here. We're in verse 23, and so I'll read a little bit of this. It says, from there, Elisha, remember he was at Jericho, from there Elisha went up to Bethel. And as he was walking along the road, some youths came out of the town and jeered at him. Now, we're going to go into this and help you understand a little bit more about the youths, because right up front, before you get too scared, I don't want you to think of youths as the little children that are real nice that we just, with the veggie tail, sent downstairs. We're talking about older youths, and I'll give you the actual definition in just a few minutes. Then in verse 24, he turned around. They were jeering him. They were mocking. They were dissing. They were doing all that stuff. And he turned around, and he looked at them and called down a curse on them in the name of the Lord. Then two bears came out of the woods and mauled 42 of the youths. And he went on to Mount Carmel, and from there returned to Samaria. Pretty common. All in a day's work, right? Pretty unusual situation. Now remember, Elijah here is stacking up some more wins. He had a pretty good start. When Elijah left and Elisha took his mantle, and then he walked over to the Jordan River, he was going to go back across, and he thought, well, what would Elijah do? And so he rolled that thing up, touched the water, stepped in, and the water parted, and he walked across. And those who were following and watching had to be impressed. It's like, wow, that's what Elijah did. And so that was pretty neat. Last week, we looked at the fact that when he was in Jericho, and remember, the people in the area were just so upset because the water was bitter and cursed and bad, and it caused all the farm fields around to be sterile. Nothing was growing. Why? Because Jericho became one of the centers of Baal worship in Israel. The nation of Israel made Baal their national god, and they centered a lot of it was in Jericho, a lot going on out of there. And Baal, who was the god of fertility, our God, Jehovah God, cursed that fertility and made everything sterile. The water was bad, you couldn't drink it, and the fields wouldn't grow and produce anything. And so Elisha comes up there, takes a bowl, pours a bunch of Morton salt in it, dumps it into the big, gigantic spring. And from that day until the year 2011 AD, the water there is extremely sweet and good, productive, and the fields are growing and things are going really well. Boy, Elisha is stacking up a bunch of victories. He's starting to look like God's man. Now, here he is, he's heading toward Bethel, And he has another issue to deal with. Sort of like what Elijah did too. Remember, Elijah had the confrontations with the prophets of Baal, and he massacred them. It was a great victory. So as he's traveling along, and he's going 15 miles from the Wadi of Jericho up through the dense forests, and that's all around the city of Bethel, he's going to go there, and he's going to visit the school of prophets that Elijah had set up. He gets attacked by this gang of hostile young people. These are not children. Don't mistake that. In fact, the word here is the same one used in 1 Kings chapter 3 when it was talking about Solomon when he was 20 years old. Okay? 20 years old is not a child. They may act like a child sometimes, but they're not. They're not. Some 80-year-olds act like children sometimes. And the same word is used in 1 Samuel chapter 13. It's also used in 1 Samuel chapter 16. David, King David, when he was being elevated and was declared a brave warrior because of the things, same thing. He was called a youth in those situations. There's many cultures. I don't think the United States is one of them, but there's many cultures around the world that consider a youth, and this would be true here, as someone who is a single person up from the teens up to about age 30. I know in Argentina, just for one, Gary McCammon does a lot of youth ministries, and he has a big national youth camp once a year, and he will tell you all the time that, remember, this includes people up until age 30. So if you're 29 and a half years old and single, you go to the youth camp. That's who we're talking about here. These are not young, very, very young, need help kind of people who are doing this. This group does happen to be a misdirected, irresponsible group of juvenile delinquents. And they're intent on disrupting and discrediting the ministry of Elisha. That's all they want to do. They want to make God look bad. They want this guy to look bad because they are entrenched in the national religion of Baal worship, and they're opposed to the God Almighty. They were probably trained by some of the calf-worshipping priests of Bethel, and they were sent out to do this particular dirty deed. Now, so often in our culture, we sometimes tend to side with the guilty person. Maybe you don't. I hope you don't. I try not to. But sometimes we, you know, here's a bunch of young people who are doing an evil, evil thing, a horrible thing, and our inclination is, oh man, Bear's got these little children. That's sad. And it's not like that. Catch that. It's not like that. These are well-orchestrated young people opposing God. They said and they did exactly as they were trained. They had foul names. They used bad language. Just like in our culture, you can talk to any child, any age, and you can pretty much find out what it's like at home, can't you? And you know the kinds of languages that are used, and it's not hard to figure that out. Kids do that because not only do we disciple people into Jesus Christ, but you can disciple people into all the bad and wrong and destructive things as well. And a lot of them get that way. So when we look at this, in this text, one of the things I asked myself is God's word relevant or what? It is. It's relevant. What's going on here in our culture today, we would say, is bullying. It's bullying. And so, you know, how do you deal with bullying? What do you do with that? And I've got to be really honest, and I've also got to be careful, because for a couple decades, Ann would have encouraged me not to share how you deal with bullying the way that I was taught to deal with bullying, okay? So we're not going to do that. So I added in my notes, it's not on the screen, but I added, how do you deal with bullying correctly. So that's what we'll talk about for a second. First of all, there's several kinds, verbal bullying. You know, when people are just attacking you, saying bad things, saying horrible stuff about you, what do? Well, you walk away, and then you report it to someone if it's important enough to do. You let somebody know if you think it's serious enough that it has to be dealt with. Some things you just listen to and you take it because life is that way. But verbal, you should report it if it's that bad. Physical bullying, and that happens. People beat up people or push them around or whatever, and I won't go into a lot of detail there, at least in my situation. But the best thing to do is you escape and then you report it. You try to get out of there and you let somebody know what's going on. And then the other kind is social networking. Now this is the one that I hear about a lot because, you know, what all do we have? We have Twitter, and we have Facebook, and all kinds of electronic means of communication. And I do know that, although those can be used for really, really good things, I try to, but they can also be used for really, really bad and hurtful and harmful things. And kids struggle with that today. And some of the stuff that you can see on that between kids flying back and forth is absolutely vicious, absolutely vicious. So what do you do with that? Well, here's a bright idea, it's not from me. Turn it off. You'd be surprised. I've talked to parents whose kids were having trouble because they're getting bombarded on Facebook or on the Twitter, and I said, well, tell them not to read it, not to look at it, turn it off. And it's almost like the parents are, oh, you can't do that. Everybody's gotta be. It's like, turn it off. You don't need that stuff. For 10,000 years we haven't had it. You don't have to read what everybody says nasty on Facebook. You don't have to do it. But the good news about social networking, boys and girls, is if you report it to the right place, big trouble happens. Big trouble. And so, you know, if you turn, for instance, I'll say this example. If someone comes to me and they have something they want to share and report, one thing that I've had over the years happen occasionally in counseling situations is for someone to say to me, Pastor Bud, I need to tell you something, but you have to promise not to tell anybody. Okay? That's not a surprise to you that I hear that once in a while. You know what my first response to them is? Okay, but you need to know that if what you tell me is illegal or someone, including yourself, is going to get hurt, I am obligated by law to report that to the police. So if you want to tell me, go ahead and tell me. Some people say, oh, maybe not, you know, but usually they do because it's not usually that big. But once in a while it is. And once in a while we have to say something. If people are doing things that are that bad to you, that you need help, then they're gonna get in trouble. Sometimes I think our kids are afraid that, no, it's only gonna get worse on me. It's gonna get worse on them, too. So we need to just realize, get away from it, report it, go for help where you can go. Now, Elisha wasn't on Facebook. He didn't have one set up yet. And, you know, he didn't have those kinds of things. And here he's being jeered and attacked and made fun of, but it's far worse than that. It's not an attack on Elisha as much as it is a direct attack on God Almighty. Bethel had long been the center of evil in Israel. It had one of the areas that Jeroboam set up all these idols, and it had become entrenched. During Jezebel's time in recent years, it became a place where there were sensuous rites that took place in practicing worship of these idols. Hosea called it Beth Aven. Not Beth El, he called it Beth Aven. And that means this: it means house of wickedness instead of house of God. So that's the reputation of what's going on here. The last time Elisha was here was when he was with Elijah. These people had heard of Elijah's translation, that he got taken up by chariots and was with God. And they knew about Elisha's new direction of ministry, and they felt they needed to do a direct assault on God and his name, and they were going to do everything they could to deter what was going on in the name of God, and they're struggling against Jehovah. Now, this is after Baal's already been defeated once by God with Elijah. Now they're coming back for more. And these young people who are scorning God and leading people away from him are doing things that have eternal consequences. They are trying to attack God, but they're trying to take people away from the one true God and honoring of him and worshiping of him and getting them to go in another direction that will condemn them for all eternity. Pretty serious stuff. This is just not sticks and stones. This is people who are fighting over eternal issues. By mocking the messenger of God, misusing the prophets, it's one of what Chronicles said is the crying sins of Israel. And in that chapter in 2 Chronicles 36, where it says that, it tells about how that's one thing that they did to attack the prophets of Israel, and God judged them for generations because of what they were going through. It tells us Elijah looked at them and called down judgment. Now, I'm going to suggest that although you can't see it in a verse or two, there was probably some time that passed here. I don't think somebody called him a name and he spun around and cursed them. I don't think it happened like that. I think this was an ordeal that went on and on and on and on, and he probably listened and heard for a good while with some patience. A good note to remember here is that our acts and even our words are noticed by God. It all is. God knows what's going on. So two bears come out of the woods, and they mauled 42 young people. Now, we want to remember, there's a difference between personal wrongs, which were expected by God and taught by Jesus to forgive, and there's a difference between that and deliberate acts and attacks upon God and his work of salvation. We're supposed to do well under personal things and respond appropriately. The Apostle Paul gave a couple examples of personal attacks. In 2 Timothy chapter 4, he reminds Timothy about that guy, we only know him as Alexander the metal worker, and he did all kinds of things to attack the ministry of Paul, and Paul just said, you know, he's going to pay the price for that. And Paul would understand that because in Romans chapter 12 and those verses 17, 18, and 19, you know the phrase where God said, vengeance is mine, saith the Lord, I will repay. And my experience has been, if I'm mad, really, really mad, I don't get that way, but if I really, really get mad at somebody and want to get them, let God do it. He's really, really good at that. Way better than I am. No matter how bad I want to get that person, God could get them a lot worse than I could ever do. These young people, and by the way, it could include females in this too, they were mauled. Literally, it means they were cut in pieces. But it does not necessarily demand that they died. And I've read a bunch of commentaries, and some say they were killed, some say they were injured and were able to have a second chance kind of thing with God. I have no idea which it was. All I know is that God's judgment is a very strange work. Sometimes it's delayed. Sometimes it appears as though it's not going to happen at all. Sometimes it comes quickly and suddenly. But in truth, God's judgment cannot be avoided. Often, when God delays judgment, it may be that he does not want them to perish. In 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 9, it tells us there, you know that verse, that God's not willing that anyone should ever perish, but that all should come to repentance. It begins with, God is not slack concerning his promises. Why hasn't Jesus returned yet? Everybody thinks he should have by now. Should have been September 25th or whenever that guy said it was, or it could have been long ago. It could have been with the Six-Day War in the 70s. It could have been all kinds of times. Why hasn't God returned? Well, one reason is he's trying to rescue as many people as he can. He's being gracious and not returning immediately so that you had a chance to become a believer in Christ and spend eternity with him, so that your loved one that you're still working on, that you can pray for and witness to, will get saved and can be rescued. But in Psalm 37, he does say, a little while and the wicked will be no more. Though you look for them, they will not be found. God will judge. So Elijah continues on and he goes into Bethel. He's not afraid. Not afraid of those false priests. He's not afraid of the parents of those 42 youths or their families. They're not going to do anything to him. He's got God on his side. You know, it seems like whenever somebody makes progress toward God and they're doing well and they want to be used of God and his purposes, it seems like the enemies of God rally around to oppose them. Jesus warned us about that in John 16. He said, I have told you these things so that you may have peace. In this world you have trouble, but take heart, I have overcome the world. Jesus knew that you were going to face spiritual darkness, opposition in your life for Christ. And he wants us to be at peace during even that time, so that we could grow and mature spiritually, because he has overcome that. Our words and our actions will help us show who we are, just like these youth who showed what they were like by their actions, by the words, we do too. And we need to stand firm for Jesus Christ. Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians 15 at the end of that great passage that speaks about the resurrection that's yet to come. At the very end, he says this, therefore, my dear brothers, stand firm. Stand firm. That's all we need to hear. It's just stand firm. Stay rock solid in Jesus Christ. Let nothing move you. Always give yourself fully to the work of the Lord. Now, Elisha, it may seem like that's a hard thing to do because they're going to mock you and oppose you, and there's going to be obstacles like crazy, but stand firm. Always do the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. Sometimes today, our labor in the Lord is in vain. It's difficult. And we don't see the results of it. And we think, man, isn't anybody paying attention? Isn't even God watching what's going on? But there is a day of reward. There's a day of when Christ will make everything right. And there's an eternity to be spent with him where he is going to honor all those things that are done in his name. I'm going to close our service with a word of prayer. Let's pray. Father, how we thank you so much for the guidance that we get in this life and your leading toward us and just giving an example like Elisha. God, we want to live lives that are fruitful, productive, honoring to you. But sometimes we get slaughtered here. Sometimes it's difficult. Our own circumstances of life or maybe oppositions that we face. But you are God, and we just honor you for who you are and pray that you would dwell in us with great power, have freedom to work in our hearts so that we can live for you. Thank you again, Lord, for so many here who honor you and live for you. And we lift them up and give them thanks and honor as well. And we pray, Lord, that you would help each one of us to do the very best we can in bringing glory to the name of Jesus. In his name we pray. Amen.